IVM.
Hello and welcome to Football Twaddle. My name is Saru. As usual, I have Baru with me.
What's up, guys?
And there is no Kumar Kanav, as usual again. God, that guy is missing out.
But I think we have leveled up today.
Leveled up, really? Is that what you're going
much.
To say? We've struck much higher than Kumar Kanav. As once Kanav said he isn't coming, we're like, you know what? Screw you.
we'll
get an India pro. So, welcome, Stephen Dias.
Hi, thank you.
You've been playing for India and football for how many years now?
I mean, it's been 10 years I played for Indian team.
And you started playing football how many years ago now?
Started playing football, I mean, professionally I played like 99.
Oh, God.
1999, yes.
Yes, I think, yeah, we don't need Kanav.
You've got all the knowledge you need. Like,
yeah. So we are going to talk about a few things. One is the Arsenal versus Tottenham match, which happened.
Yes.
Because we have to talk about it. And we're going to pick Steven's brains on what happens during a halftime. I thought they just eat like a sandwich and come out, but apparently a lot more happens in the football pitch.
Apparently.
Yeah. So we're going to talk to him about that. We're going to talk about the state of Indian football. Whatever happening is happening to Mumbai football with no club being here right now. And Steven has his own academy as well. So now they are in there. You have a branch in Kurla and you also have a branch in
Churchgate.
So yeah, it's doing quite well, and we will talk about youth
so
development.
This is FC Mumbai Cars, is it?
No, this it's called is? Ambitious Football Academy.
Okay.
One is with the Karnataka,
right, KSA ground, and one is in Don Bosco Kurla.
Okay.
Yes. So that is the agenda for today.
Wow, we have an agenda today.
Dude, we are so prepped.
Pro.
Yeah. So pro. Oh, by the way, Steven, we don't do like this. We just like walk in and say, bhai.
Aaj kya baat karna hai?
So we put in extra effort because you are coming in. All right. So let's start. Before we get to talk about Steven, Baru, whatever happened, 2-1 down at halftime and Arsenal won 4-2.
What a match, man. I mean, you know, with the first goal that we got, that penalty, and Oba just slots it in, I was like, this is our day. We were completely dominating Tottenham. It was like the Liverpool match all over again. And I told you this last week, Arsenal is really stepping up its game in the big games nowadays, ever since, you know, Emery has found his place in the team. And we might have lost the first two games, but whatever.
Those are the first two.
So anyway, I knew that they were going to hit the ground running with this amazing team, the amazing way that, you know, Unai has been playing. And they did that. Tottenham it completely on the back foot. They had no idea, you know, where all these attacks and all those balls were coming from. And that final breakthrough came, you know, through Oba because of that penalty, which at least there was one penalty in the match which was rightly called. And
wow,
then suddenly, a couple of minutes later, Tottenham get a stupid light touch penalty. Do you think that was a penalty, Steven? Did you watch that one? So basically what happened was Son had the ball and Holding came sliding in, and his the tip of his stud slightly brushed against Son's ankle. And as soon as there was contact, Son just, you know, dived and made a meal out of it. And obviously the ref, like,
look,
just,
one
it was Mike Dean.
One thing I would like to say is that even if Steven ever fell over for light touches, he's not going to admit on this show. So there's no point talking to him about it.
You know, the minute Mike Dean gave Arsenal a penalty, I was like, okay, he's totally going to balance it all out in the next half. But we didn't have to wait for the next half. We did it right there.
Yes, but what happened was that Spurs score, obviously, two goals. They go into halftime at 2-1 down. Emery makes changes in the halftime.
Something Wenger would have never done.
Like, yeah, Wenger never used to change.
He was a little
conservative.
Conservative and stubborn, you know, when it came to his game plan. Either maybe I should wait till the 70th minute and he'll finally, go through.
Yeah.
But I'm glad he made those changes, got Iwobi out, who was trying a little extra with his, you know, ball control and his ball holding. Got Mickey out, who was doing nothing in the match. Or for that matter, for the past two or three games.
So they're like Pogba and Lukaku.
Instant impact, he got in Ramsey. And he got in Guendouzi, was it?
No, not Guendouzi.
He got Laka.
Yeah, you also. Alright, so this is a good way, good place to get in, Steven. A team, let's say your team is trailing 2-1. A very important game. You go into the dressing room. What does a manager tell you that you come out winners 4-2?
I mean, I feel that's the, you know, quality of a coach. I have played under different coaches. So, I mean, I feel coach is one kind of a motivator.
Hmm.
So, there were so many coaches I played under. Like, that's the important time, half-time, where coach comes. And I mean, I never come across coaches like who comes and, you know, shout at players and all. Because if you shout at that time, if someone shout at me half-time like I'm trailing 2-1, my confidence will go down.
So even
that
more
time,
down.
Yeah. So that time, that's the important time when coach comes. He motivate players. He tells player what's his individual quality. So he gives so much confidence to players and all. Especially I was in Indian team. Sir Bob Houghton was there.
Yes.
So whenever we used to like down or match is going 0-0, we used to come halftime. The way he used to motivate us, like, you know, I used to get goosebumps.
Really?
Like in halftime. Seriously. He was like, the kind of motivation he used to give, that was like, so whenever we used to go second half, so we all pump up, like, you know,
yeah.
Players and all, we used to talk, like, you know, the coach is like, you know, he's helping us, supporting us so much, like, let's play for him and all. So that's where that performance used to come second half.
Are there enough tactical instructions given out during halftime? How much can a coach tell in halftime that
hasn't already said before that, the match started?
No, he can't give too many, you know, instruction, because it's 15 minutes break. Like when you come in halftime, 5 minutes you have to like go change whatever you want to change your starts. Or so 10 minutes, like he don't give too much instruction, but whatever important thing, if he feels like, you know, defenders are not doing good or midfielder, only like small instruction he can give.
Yeah.
But mostly he motivates that time. He don't give too much of whatever instruction he gives before match. Halftime is only important thing, like if something is very important, he tell the players.
Hmm.
But mostly all the coaches, they motivate all the players so they can go second half and then they can perform.
Okay. And also, there's this cliche we keep hearing in football that if a team concedes one goal at the 45th minute, it's like, oh, the halftime talk is going to change completely. How completely does it change? If like, yeah, you still know you're going down, like you're going in the 1-0 down, right? A coach obviously is not going to make up his halftime talk 10 minutes before the half finishes. So does such things matter in the halftime?
I mean, we concede like before halftime.
Just before halftime.
Hmm.
So what happens then? Let's say you're supposed to win the game anyway, right? It is 0-0. It does not matter if you go 1-0 down. You still have to go ahead and play and win the game. So the instruction shouldn't change that much, right, during halftime?
As I said, like, you know, he can't come and, you know, shout at players and all, like, you concede like silly goals or something like that. So players will go more down and lose their confidence. So I feel coach will come and talk to him, like, and if you see, mostly I observe in football, like, the first 15 minutes and last, like, 10 minutes, mostly goals scored in those time, like, you know. So coaches, they always prepared for this time. Whenever we start game, coach always tells, like, you know, be careful this first 15 minutes. He tells the defender, like, be careful and last 10 minutes. So
apparently Mourinho is not giving that instruction. Have you seen Manchester United? They're only conceding goals in the first 15 minutes and the last 10
they're
minutes.
They're actually number one on the table of conceding the most goals in the first 15 minutes. They've conceded 6 goals, I think.
Yeah, so I think what happens is Mourinho says, please don't concede goals. They say, let's see what you do.
And United are also like Arsenal this season, the whole comeback sense.
Yes.
So I think they don't have an option, right? Abhi pehle 15 minute mein concede kar liya. Abhi. You, the only way is like coming back.
Always 2-2, 3-2. They actually,
and Fellaini 90 plus 1, 90 plus 2 pay goal.
The last match also, I think they drew 2-2.
2-2.
They were losing 2-0. And
Southampton.
Then, yeah.
Yeah. But it felt like it.
But
like,
that's the thing about opposition coaches nowadays. That when you play against United and you happen to draw it, they get fired. Like, United ko nahi hara paya tha.
What is going
he
on
got
here?
Fired.
Yeah, Marcus. I don't think he got fired for drawing. He got fired for conceding 2 goals.
Who's United's account?
Have you seen Lukaku's first touch?
And Lukaku scored after, I don't know, like almost 1,000 minutes of not
minutes.
Scoring a goal.
Have you ever been in such a form, like
goal drought
that you're trying everything and you're not even you're not scoring goals, and because that you're putting more effort, and then that is like resulting in you just doing even worse in trying to score goals. What does a player do to get out of such form, bad luck and bad form?
So as a coach,
as a player, what does it take?
See, it's, I can say like, if he's putting so much effort but he still can't score,
he should leave the club.
not leave the club. Then again, on coach and his teammate to give him confidence, like, you know, if you, again, you shout at him and then you put him down, then again, it's bad for team also.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because if he don't score, and again, team will be in problem.
Tell me
so
about
support
it.
Him, yeah, support him, give him some encouragement, so maybe he will score then.
So yes. All my teammates who are listening to this, don't yell at me if I'm not scoring.
No, if he's not putting effort and then you're telling him, you're shouting at him, I understand. But if you can see like he's putting effort, he's doing everything, but he still can't score, then that's...
Yeah. So...
I can just imagine the joy that Lukaku must have felt here after finally scoring after 968 minutes.
Yeah.
It's an amazing sense of relief. I mean, I don't score for one match and I'm like, oh.
You know what happened? The match before this, the before Southampton, which was the match they played, Crystal Palace. So Lukaku scored a goal, which I don't think was an offside, but he scored a goal. And he was like, you know, ki ho gaya abhi. He was just like dusting his shirt off and just running. And then the referee says offside. And he's like, oh God, no way. I had to start all over again. Yeah, that's about Lukaku. Let's talk a little about Steven's career. He started off when there was no this Tamasha, ISL.
Bollywood had no idea football existed.
Yeah, Ranbir Kapoor did not support Barcelona. All of that. He was like, you know, he
neither played in movies nor in real life.
He played football because he loved football. And he joined a club because they wanted to support football, I guess. So, Steven, how did this whole thing start? When did you start playing football? Why did you think football was like, isi mein karna hai abhi?
So the thing is, where I stay, there is a Don Bosco Kurla.
Yes.
So if you see Don Bosco, mostly people, they play either basketball or football. Not much many people who plays cricket and all. So that's how I started football. I was practicing in Don Bosco. There was a brother called Brother Frank Braganza. So he used to teach us how to play football. My all brothers were into football.
Okay.
So one of my brother used to be very good footballer. I mean, people used to know him because of his shooting and all. So I always wanted to be like him, like, you know. So I followed his footsteps. So because my brother was a footballer, I could be a footballer. Otherwise, everyone knows Mumbai meaning is all about cricket.
Yeah.
So I know there's so many footballers who are better than me. But because of some family issues, they had to take up job and all, so they didn't got a proper support.
Luck also plays quite an important part, right?
Yes, of course. So yes, that's why, because of Don Bosco and also, I started playing football. So initially I was playing for Don Bosco. Then I used to go for trials and all, wherever I used to know, like, trial is going on.
Did you guys win the MSSA when you were in Don Bosco?
No, Don Bosco is not a school. Kurla, okay. Don Bosco is not a school.
Okay.
So, because of a local boy, they used to allow us to practice us and all. So, yeah. I never played for MSSA and all. I wish I could play because they do really good, this MSSA tournaments and all.
Yeah, at least nowadays, they're really well organized. And
yeah, every age group they have and all. I think that's important for, especially for Mumbai football. Because there is no many tournaments where the kids get to play and all. So this kind of tournament, at least the kids, they get interest
exposure
to.
And
because of ISL, of course, everyone start knowing football in Mumbai. So, yeah, many youth that start taking interest in football now.
Yeah,
I think you have to give it to ISL for that at least. I mean, the exposure is crazy. I-League, I mean, Bombay had like two I-League sides. There was Air India, there was Mumbai FC. This is basically after Mahindra shut down. And even then, it wasn't like, apart from the Yellow Brigade, which supported Mumbai FC, there wasn't like really a whole culture of going to a stadium and watching and, you know, supporting a club. But with ISL, like in the first season when we were in D.Y. Patil, I think they were average crowds of like 15,000 people watching a football match. That was unheard of. And for, you know, people who have grown up on English football, watching that stadium and, you know, just seeing that atmosphere on TV, actually going to the stadium and experiencing it used to like just give you goosebumps, like, wow. Yeah. And I can only imagine that as a player, we were in the stands, but as a player, when you were on the ground, like, what is that whole feeling like?
Of course, I mean, as a player, I'll tell you, if fans are like supporting you, and I played that first season of ISL, I played for Delhi Dynamos. Mm-hmm. When we used to play in Delhi Stadium, like 30,000-35,000 crowd used to come. And whenever we played for Indian team in Delhi also, like the crowd, like full pack crowd used to be there. Mm-hmm. So that it makes difference. Like, you know, they motivate their players, like throughout the game they'll cheer for you. So that thing very important, and because of ISL and all that thing, it's came here in India now. People are start following, because you know, Mumbai winning, if I stay in Mumbai, I feel like it's my team,
right?
So people start going for matches. That's how people, they know, like, you know, football is there in Mumbai.
That's how loyalty is built as well.
So now I stay in Mumbai, I always want, like, you know, Mumbai City FC should win and all. So that one good thing happened because of ISL, that everyone start knowing about football.
So you have your crowd cheering for you, but there's also the dark side of it. Like, if you make a mistake, or, you know, not just your fans, opposition fans anyway, you know, they keep abusing you, they try to pull you down. But sometimes when you make a mistake, you find out that even your home fans are, like, you know, trying to pull you down, or like just throwing expletives at you, trying to bully you or something. You know, how does a footballer, like,
that happens when you play for clubs. I mean, when I play for Indian team, that never happened. But yeah, club, when that happened. But then when you, then
does it actually help? Like,
That helps. Of course that helps. Like when the opponent fans, when they, you know, put you down and all, I feel motivated that time. You know, I feel like, you know, let's do it and let's show them, kind of.
Because that happened yesterday.
So Eric Dier, after scoring the goal, he basically like
ran to the Arsenal fan section and just asked them to, you know.
But more than that, he asked Aaron Ramsey to.
So Aaron Ramsey was a substitute. He was still warming up, and when Dier goes in, tries to shush the fans, all Arsenal substitutes, they come onto him and they push him away, and he tells Ramsey, "You go and sit down." And at halftime,
Ramsey substituted.
Ramsey comes in.
Two assists.
So I can see like how that helps, you know, like suddenly you want to give
that thing in India. If when you go to play in Calcutta, this thing you will get to see. Like when you play against Bagan, when you play against East Bengal, the fans will come, they will abuse you, they'll try to put you down.
But
so that's where, as a footballer, you know, you get motivated, like, you know, I want to shut this crowd. Like, so when you beat them and all, like, you know, these fans are then, they start abusing their own players then. That's how it happened in Calcutta. Okay.
But the thing about Calcutta,
like,
is like
Palace fans,
not just verbal attacks, but there have been times when stones have been thrown.
Yeah, of course, stones.
The Calcutta derby has been crazy. I mean, 1 lakh people, 50,000 love you, 50,000 hate you. And
yeah, but one thing I feel bad about, like for myself, like I wanted to play in Calcutta, because if you see, if you are a professional footballer player and if you don't play in Calcutta, then you know, you feel something is missing. Because that craze, what's there in Calcutta, that I can't see anywhere else. If you go to see derby match, East Bengal Mohun Bagan,
80,000, 1 lakh people.
Of course, that scene is like, it's crazy.
I think that's something that every Indian football fan should have on their itinerary.
Yeah, they should definitely.
And quickly, before something happens to the I-League and then ISL. And there are already talks that Mohun Bagan have agreed to join ISL.
Do they have 550 lakh rupees?
They have.
That is the payment amount for it.
Both the clubs, I think they are trying to get into ISL. The ISL. Even East Bengal is
so
trying.
So there are things that it's possible that EB would come in as a single entity, but MB might merge with ATK or something, and you know,
that is so
retain the identity.
Yeah.
Because anyway, ATK don't, like, what is the full form of ATK even now, man?
Amar Tumar Kolkata, no, like,
that was just a slogan, man. I don't think ever since Atletico moved out,
Yes.
They have been without a proper identity.
But then I'm worried that, you know, if East Bengal and Mohun Bagan will join ISL, what about the I-League then? Then what
I-League,
happened to
I-League?
I'm
telling you, it will become the second division.
But why should it become the second division is the
question. I'll tell you why. Because Reliance owns ISL. And Praful Patel.
And the country.
And Praful Patel is friend with Mr. Mukesh Ambani. And no one cares for I-League.
Yeah, that's... I think that's
pretty much something
well summarized.
You don't have to answer that, Steven. That's between me and Tanuj. So if something happens, that's on us.
Like even today, this guy, the head of Minerva, he was having a Twitter fight with some with Chiranjit, the Fan Garage podcast guy.
He's having a fight
on Twitter and
warning me here on you.
He was having a fight.
Our producer is giving us juicy insights to it.
Oh, really? Anyway, I'm not even interested in what they thought about. One thing I want to know, you played for so long, for so many clubs. I told a friend of mine that, you know, we were getting you on the show. And he's like, oh my God, kya crosses marta tha yaar. And I was like, tujhe yaad hai? He said, of course I remember. I used to watch him at like Mahindra and stuff. And instantly he tells me, are, he's also known as Beckham of India, na? I said, I mean, I read it. I didn't know that anyone else would have like known it. Did you know this? When did you become this Beckham of India? Kisne banaya aapko Beckham of India?
I remember. I mean, it's a...
Is this a Limca record certificate or something?
No, it's a big thing. Like, you know, people, they call me by that name. I don't think so. I deserve that because...
No, I mean, we've seen your long-range shots.
Yeah, we've seen
your...
You let us decide whether you deserve it or not.
No, I used to be a huge fan of David Beckham. So maybe because I used to see him playing... I start, maybe people think that I
emulated his game or something.
So, you used to cross the ball unbelievably good. How long do you practice on a weekly basis to get those crosses right?
No, I used to practice a lot because when I was playing for Air India, like 2000. So, Mr. Bimal Ghosh was my coach. So, I think this crosses I improve under him because after training, he used to sit there, he used to, you know, some player used to, whoever wants to do extra training, used to sit there, used to ask them, like, you know, do whatever you feel like doing. So because of crosses and all, people, they used to tell me, like, you know, you have a good cross and all. So I thought I'll develop more and more. So he used to help me. So I think that's how I improved. Like, after training session, I used to do extra crosses and all. I never counted, like, how many I did. But, like, at least for half an hour, 1 hour, I used to do extra training for that.
Really? On a daily basis?
On a daily basis, yeah.
God, we can't even play FIFA on the PlayStation for half an hour on a daily basis.
No, not only, like, crosses. Sometimes I used to do shooting practice, sometimes crosses.
You mean extra training put in, apart from the regular?
Apart from the training, yes.
All right. On that note, we take a break right now. And after the break, you know, there is still, there was one more derby, which was the Liverpool versus Everton one. And it was so pissing off that Jordan Pickford, of all people, had to ruin my life. We talk about that and we continue to talk to Steven about the future of Mumbai football, as well as the plans he has for his academy and how things are going. Stay tuned to Football Twaddle.
Hey, it's been another great week on IVM Podcast. If you're not following us on social media, please, please, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Our Instagram page is actually pretty interesting. The stories we do are the team and what they're doing on a day-to-day basis, and you know, they're pretty kind of fun. Take a look at them, let us know what you think. This week on Cyrus Says, Cyrus's guest is writer and journalist Namita Devidayal. She talks about how she got into journalism, her background in Indian classical music, and her upcoming book titled The Sixth String of Vilayat Khan. On The Seen and the Unseen, Amit Verma's guest is a cricket commentator and journalist whose voice most cricket fans can identify. I hope you guessed that is Harsha Bhogle. He spoke to Amit about the evolution of Indian cricket, its rise, and the changes that he has witnessed over the years. Really, really great episode, and we're really excited to have Harsha on the network. Please definitely check it out. We also launched a brand new show called The Paperback Podcast, hosted by Racheta Sharma and Satyajit Roy. Every week, they'll talk to industry experts about five of their favorite nonfiction books. The first episode featuring Apurva Damani of Artha Ventures is out on the 5th. On the Rediscovery Podcast final episode of this season, Ambika and Hosha talk to Pankil Shah and Sumit Gambhir. They talk food, travel, and the secret ingredients to a decade of managing Indian restaurants. Pankil and Sumit were also participants in our other show, The Kolaba Cartel, so it would definitely be a fun conversation and definitely check them out. And with that, let's move on with the shows.
Welcome back to Football Portal. Baru, as always, is here.
Yeah.
And we still have the Beckham of India, as they called him. And you need to listen to the first half of the show to understand why Stephen Dias is here. Thanks, Stephen, so much again for being here. So, there was one more match yesterday. Just let's put it as a segue to talk more about football and Indian football. Is Jordan Pickford does a howler, Liverpool score, the last minute of injury time, Jurgen Klopp like runs all around the pitch like a madman. Which coach of yours is the closest in terms of that level of excitement? Running everywhere. Pagal ho jata hai, like, oh my God, we scored a goal and he just like runs and hugs every player.
No, I haven't come across to any coach like that who runs in the pitch and stuff and all. But yeah, all the coaches I saw, they get excited. But player comes off the pitch and hug coaches and all that I saw. But I haven't come across to any
Jürgen
coach.
Jürgen Klopp is one of a kind, it seems.
So he's a specimen.
Is he the one now?
Who?
Jürgen Klopp.
Yeah, he called himself the normal one. So Jürgen Klopp is the normal one. So you played under so many coaches. Who was your first coach in a professional club? I can't seem to remember that.
I think it's Air India.
Yes, Air India in 2000, Mr. Bimal Ghosh. So yeah, he was my first coach.
So it won't be wrong to say he had the most influence on your career.
Yes, of course. I think I became professional footballer is because of him. Because the kind of confidence and all he gave me. Whether I used to go some other team to practice and all.
Hmm.
So nobody had faith in me, like, you know, I'll do something good. So maybe he saw something in me. So he gave confidence and yeah, he used to always guide me and give me some extra training and all. He had told me, like, you know, before training, you have to come 1 hour before and do some weight training and stuff and all.
Okay.
And I used to follow him. So that helped me a lot.
Okay. And I moved to Bombay 7 years ago, Baru. So I really didn't know that there were so many clubs out of Mumbai. But the more you read about it, there was Mahindra, there was Air India, then there was Mumbai.
There was Mumbai, which is the last one.
And was there an ONGC team as well?
Yes, ONGC. BMFC. There used to be BMFC. So and Havertz.
Like, so there were like five.
Bharat FC also, right?
No, Bharat FC from Pune.
Pune, yeah.
So there used to be
Mumbai Tigers, was it?
Mumbai Tigers were there, yeah.
So there used to be 6-7 teams from Mumbai. And there was enough opportunity, I'm assuming, for players, if they had some sort of talent, to either be in 6-7 teams. Right now, because I know what it is right now, is that there is absolutely no club from Mumbai. So what happens to all these kids who play like in the school level, do well, or, you know, play the school championship, and then where do they go?
I think, like, you know, everybody talks about like grassroots. But I feel grassroots thing is in Mumbai doing really good. But I feel really bad, like, you know, we don't have other than Mumbai City FC, there is no any professional club. So I feel bad about the place. I think Mumbai really have great talent, good talents, but then where this place will go? They don't have any option. As you said, like, you know, when I was playing for Mahindra, there were so many teams, BMFC, Mumbai FC. So the player can choose any club and they can go and show their talent. But right now, if you see the players, either they have to go outside Mumbai. But the problem, again, going outside Mumbai is like, if any city they will go, so all the cities, they prefer the local players. So if 10 players will go for trials, maybe the one player will get chance to play. So I feel if you want to improve Mumbai football, especially Mumbai football, so we need more professional clubs where players can go and show their talents and get into the ISL or Indian team. Right now in Indian team, we have only one player, Nikhil Pujari.
Yeah.
But then I think the kind of talent we have in Mumbai, at least we should be, like, you know, more players in Indian team.
Yeah.
Yeah, because if you look at the grassroots, as Stephen has said, you have all these clubs who are pushing a lot of, you know, young players into the MDFA structure. You have your PIFA and your Kankre FCs, you know, which are the older establishments which are there. And nowadays, you're getting all these newer startups, you know. I think up north, you've got your Atlanta FC and Meera Bhayandar FC and all. These are pushing players into the MDFA structure. But ultimately, what happens is once you reach the elite division, Which is where you have all your government teams, your Air India's and your ONGC's.
But they're not there now, right?
No, they're still there. So okay. Central, I think Central Bank and whatever your bank teams. To move, you know, into I-League 2, you had to finish in the top 2. But what happened, I think last season was, or last to last season, the top 2 teams are both government entities which did not want to play in I-League 2.
Oh.
And there was no such provision for a private team which was either 3rd or 4th to then move into I-League 2. So what they've done this year is MDFA in the top division, they've created 2 segments. So one is only for your public owned teams and the other one's for your private teams. So you, regardless of what happens in that whole table structure, whoever's first and second in that private division within that top division, they get the ticket to go to the I-League 2. You know, they become eligible for it.
Yeah.
So that is a change that they've done this season now. So at least there would definitely be a team moving into I-League 2.
From Mumbai.
Assuming I-League 2 is still around by the time next year comes in.
That's a big doubt,
That's
right?
the bigger question. But yeah, so the way they've restructured it now, so you'll definitely see one of these top division teams from Bombay moving into I-League 2.
No, okay. Man.
So, personally, I feel like, you know, if you see ONGC, Air India, these teams, when they were in I-League, they produced so many players, but because of the criteria thing, they can't play I-League. But I feel they should, if they would have been I-League, I think Bombay 2 team, ONGC and Air India, if, I don't know what's the criteria and all, but AFF can, you know, give permission these 2 teams to play in I-League, again Mumbai Football come
it
in.
It seems like, so weird to me that...
Or they should at least allow, you know, some sort of a loan structure.
System, yeah.
Because what happens is players can't leave, don't want to leave these organizations because
they
ultimately
have a job.
It's a stable environment and it's stable. Why would you exit, you know, to try and enter a different team? There should be some sort of a loan system because if they're not... you know, moving above a certain level, they should at least not stop their players from going there.
There is no, I mean, there is already precedence for that. Remember,
not
when,
in these public PSU.
But remember when Bengaluru FC was not in ISL, all their players were loaned out to ISL after the first season.
Bengaluru FC is like a privately owned club.
You can just put that
the
provision.
Loan system. No, the loan system is there in the clubs, but it's not there in these entities like your ONGCs and your Air Indias.
Yeah. So, Steven, from whatever you're saying, it gets really hard for people from Mumbai, at least, to join a professional club. And when we were talking before we started this recording, you were telling, and which I think should be true for almost any city, is that a city's club will always give preference to the city's players first and then. So, you are running an academy, you have 2 branches, and... when you are training people, let's assume that, like, you there enough academies, right? What happens, like, when you train a person to the age of 13-14? Like, what if someone has to try and play for a club? What does that path look like for that person?
As I said, there are no professional clubs in Mumbai, but what we're trying to do in our academy is, like, I personally feel and the people who work with me, I feel we want to work more on a basic football. Basic football as in, like, you know, how to trap the ball. I personally feel like whatever difference we have, like Indian football and what you see in English Premier League and foreign football, like, I think that's the only difference I feel, like, you know, that basic football. So they have, like, you know, when they trap the ball, like, before trapping the ball, they know, like, where they have to pass. And I feel the Indian football, like, we trap the ball and then
we look up
like, where I think if that thing will change in India, so, you know, the basic football, how to trap, passing the ball and the basic thing, if a kid can do in these things, like, really good, I think Indian football can improve. So we more focusing on that thing,
on the technical ability,
yes. And so decision making, like, you know, before ball comes, where you have to, you need to know, like, where you're going. So if you can improve that in a kid, so when they come in professional football, I think they will find very easy.
So at what stage, see, genetically Indians are a little, you know, slighter build than the international footballers. So at what stage do you think should all this weight management, weight training, muscle building for Indian footballers start? Because suddenly you realize that if you don't start controlling the diet from a very young age, at a certain point it just becomes too late, you know, because
Should start the moment they start playing in academies when they train and all. From that time they should know, like, you know, when you have classes and all. So that's classes also, like, important other than training. That kid should know what is right to eat, what not to eat. If they don't know, then again it's a problem. And so after like certain age, if you try to control that thing, it's difficult.
It's too late.
So when you train them in academy and all about nutrition, they should know. And we personally, we in our academy, we call a professional nutrition to tell what's the good thing for kids and all.
Mm-hmm.
So I think when they are small only, they should know, like, you know, what is right to eat, what not to eat. Even you have to tell their parents about
it. Exactly.
So that's the important thing. If you don't convince their parents, then it's difficult.
You have to convince only them, man, Baru.
No, because what I was thinking is that even nowadays, when you look at India playing all these international teams, technically you can see that Indians do have the technical ability and the pace and that agility is there. But
physically,
even before the match starts, when you look at the teams lining up, there is an immense difference between, you know, even the average heights of the players and all, and the bodybuilding and everything.
Dude, average height is such a misnomer. Like,
people just get, you know, out-muscled.
Messi is 5'6". And Bunty, a.k.a. Lucas Torreira.
No, but these guys are still built, right? I mean, Lucas Torreira, for that matter, it's...
He's like a small, big mass.
He uses that lower center of gravity to his advantage. Dude, it's hard to...
I just want to tell you one thing. You know, Steven was talking about the diet and how they counsel parents and coaches and everything. He does so much more in his academy than so many ISL clubs do for their professional players playing. They just go to buffet and eat like pinned chole.
Where have you seen this happening?
I shall tell you this off record.
What, pindi chole? What?
Yeah, dude, they eat anything and everything. One naan, please.
Oh, are you talking about the hospitality box or something?
No, no. Players, Baba.
No, in the hospitality box, there's always away section players who are like not playing the match, right?
No, not those guys. Come on. Those guys seem like, man, whatever.
Because we were sitting behind Ian Hume the other day. And
yeah. Oh, I didn't see what he was angry. Eating. These guys were sitting. So, Kanav and Baru were sitting behind Ian Hume. And there was a penalty call which went against... Who does he play for now? He changes teams every 6 months.
I think he's with Goa now.
He's with... Abhe, kuch bhi.
Or Pune, I don't know. Goa or Pune?
He's playing for Pune.
Pune, right? Pune. So, yeah. Yes, he went for Pune.
Yeah, yeah.
And so there was a penalty given against Pune. And he started like screaming right behind the... Like, he was not even playing. He was injured.
And we thought he was like... abusing Mumbai players, but it turns out he was actually yelling at his own defender that how can you put that tackle in that place. You know, he was so passionate.
Yes.
It felt like he's been playing for them since a long, long time. But I think, yeah, he's just a really passionate and a really nice
footballer.
Yeah, that
you need in a player. If you don't have that passion, like, you know, it's difficult.
You become like Berbatov, you know.
Dude, he...
Who's just a United fan and nothing else.
I'm sorry, whatever said and done, Berbatov, that first touch, you can forgive anything else he does.
I'm just saying, man. I mean, he still has the second best touch in the world. Okay, I agree.
Yeah.
After Dennis Bergkamp. What do you think? Do you think Berbatov
who
is
has
like,
the best touch in the world
that
like,
you have seen
in world of football?
I have seen Raul, who had really good touch, who played for Real Madrid,
and then Schalke.
Yeah. So I saw like he got really good touch. Then in the midfielder, if you say Iniesta.
Oh God, that guy!
It's difficult to take ball from him. Although, like, whatever height, like, you know his height, and like, still it's difficult to take ball from him. So, yes, Iniesta is good.
But I just know one thing, Fellaini before the haircut.
I think
was
in defense, since we're already doing that, I think in defense, Marcelo is like, has a crazy first touch.
Yeah, he's a really good player.
More than Marcelo, I loved Ricardo Carvalho and Nesta. Those guys, they just knew, like, you know, Ricardo Carvalho used to just tell John Terry, you die whenever, but let me just do this whole thing here.
You know, he always looked like someone who's just stepped out of a time machine. He had that, you know, Beckenbauer hairstyle all the time.
Yes.
It was always like, this guy is like from the 70s or something, man.
He was so good, man. He could read the game better than anyone, especially defensive point of view. Unlike Mustafi now has those characteristics,
oh,
I would
God,
say.
Oh, God, he's got nothing of that.
All right, Steven, so we have a few more minutes left. You've started this academy, now you're training kids, you're telling them what to eat, everything. What's the future of academy? What do you see yourself doing in 5 years with your academy and other things?
This is such a job interview question. And where do you see yourself in 5 years?
No, we need to know,
the
right?
The CEO of this company.
Look, let me give a context. He's one of the few good ones. So we really need to know what he wants to do.
No, I aims to if our academy play for I-League, ISL or for Indian team, it's going to be proud moment for us also. So that's our aim. I want our academy play should play the I-League, ISL.
And I hope you're taking your coaching badges as well.
Yeah, I gave my A license exams, so I'm just waiting for the result, so hopefully I'll get through, then maybe I'll get into professional coaching.
What is it like? I believe quite a few of your generation of footballers, they are now currently coaching. I think Arata is also at Reliance.
Izumi
Arata,
wasn't he playing 2 years ago?
He was with Pune, I think, and after Pune he joined.
He played last year also.
Yeah, in ISL, I'm not sure who he was playing.
Oh, he played for Pune.
Pune only, right?
Yeah, Pune, he played for ATK.
He used to play for Pune FC.
Right now, he's with Reliance youth team.
And I think you had a match against him recently.
Yeah.
How did that turn out? Do you guys give each other stares?
No. Before match, we met because...
I mean, it was a Mumbai versus Pune thing.
For both of us, it was new thing, into coaching. So, we were talking about... But... I feel coaching is completely different than playing. Mm-hmm. When, as a player, I know, you have to go there and play for, train for 2 hours and then come home and rest.
That's it.
But as a coach, it's very difficult.
It's
come home, then you start thinking about tomorrow's training session, how to prepare that training session. Then individual player, you have to develop. You have to tell them, you have to guide them. It's a difficult job.
So is there any of those old rivalries that you guys must have had, Mumbai versus Pune? Does any of that, trickle down into your coaching, or are all those things that...
Not yet, because everything new for both of us. Mm-hmm. So it was good. They won that match, which I felt bad after match. Yeah, but it was good learning experience for me. Because if I would have won that match, I wouldn't understand the things. After match, I realized, where I have to work and stuff and all. So, which is good. It's really good learning experience for me.
So which are the youth academies, do you think, that are out there right now, which are doing a really good job, apart from...
Mumbai, I think Mumbai City FC is there. Then Reliance is doing really good because their players, they are together from, 4-5 years. So they play really good football.
Does the Tata Academy, is it still on?
Still on,
Tata Football something, right?
Yeah. Once it used to be a big name.
Yeah, the top.
But there are so many academies now. So which are doing really good. Reliance Academy is there. Now Mumbai City FC is doing good. Youth team. Mm-hmm. Pune is doing good. Pune, I think they won almost all the matches they won under 18.
In the youth league.
Yeah. Again, I will say after we talk about grassroots, every club got under 13 team, under 15 team. They have I-League under 18 team, but what about after they play under 18? They don't have any...
The roadmap is not...
Any other professional club where they can go. Again, they have to go outside Mumbai and go for trials and all, which is again... We need more professional clubs in Mumbai.
Yeah, but we should not worry that much. He'll be a coach and he'll be shouting at the people to play well. So that day is not far, hopefully. On that note, Steven, thank you very much for coming on our small little podcast and sharing us so many insights about football, Indian football, what actually happens during a match. We don't know much. So thank you very much for coming.
Thanks a lot, Steve.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yes, and Baru.
Saru.
I'm not thanking you. Nice seeing
you. I'm just acknowledging you.
Yes, exactly. All right, listeners, please follow us on Twitter @ Footy Twaddle. Facebook and Instagram is Football Twaddle. And make sure you rate us on iTunes. On that note, this is Saru signing off this week's Football Twaddle.
How aware do you think you are of your laws and rights? Do you look up to laws when you are caught up in situations? Do you know what your rights are when you're stuck somewhere bad? Well, here's a show that can help you move an inch closer to being aware of what your rights are. Tune into Know Your Kanoon with me, Amar Rana. This is a podcast meant to answer all your law-related queries. Catch Know Your Kanoon every week on the IVM website or the app or anywhere you get your podcast from.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money, now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have.